Today, we'll tell you about the first radio projects aimed to get signals from space. Together, we'll learn about one amazing equation that can help us to estimate the number of active, communicative extraterrestrial civilizations in the Milky Way galaxy. Then, we'll see how the scientists, with the use of today's technology, are searching for the signs of life on the planets of other stars. Ready? Let's go! Search for Extraterrestrial Civilizations, Part 3. Don't forget to hit the like and subscribe buttons if you want to see another video from this series. Frank Drake was the first scientist who tuned the radio to search for signals from space. It happened during the project OZMA. The scientist used a 26-meter radio telescope to examine the stars Tau Ceti and Epsilon Eridani, near the 1,420 MHz marker frequency. Both stars are among the closest to the Sun. At that time, many scientists suggested that they can have habitable planets nearby. The obtained information was stored on a tape for further analysis. During the 4 months of the experiment, 150 hours of recording was received. However, during the analysis, the researchers didn't find any recognizable signal. The only strange signal was recorded on April 8, 1960, but later it was determined to be caused by a passing plane. Anyway, OZMA was the first real project that was searching for extraterrestrial radio signals. 11 years later, in 1971, NASA, for the first time, funded a SETI project. In the final report, the team of the study suggested the construction of an Earth-based radio telescope array with 1,500 dishes, known as Project Cyclops. It was aimed to search for Earth-like radio signals at a distance of up to 1,000 light-years. Cyclops was not built due to the high price of the project. At that time, its creation would have cost around $10 billion. Anyway, the report has a very important role in the history of the search for other civilizations. It created the basis for future SETI projects. We can't say that we don't receive anything interesting from space. Sometimes we do get some strange signals, but we still cannot understand their structure. Most of them resemble the signals with which the military listens to near-Earth space. All countries have a missile defense system, and it constantly monitors the passage of satellites. And these radio pulses are most similar to the signals that we receive. Maybe they also have anti-satellite systems. Well, we can't be really sure about anything in this case. But let's go back for a moment to Frank Drake. In the early 60s, he came up with the famous Drake's equation, although it's worth noting that the idea of it was formulated in Cochoni's and Philip Morrison's article published by the Nature magazine back in 1959. Anyway, what is this equation about? Well, scientists realized that the search for extraterrestrial civilizations is a kind of problematic matter. So it must be solved piece by piece in order to estimate the number of potential correspondents in space who are ready to keep in touch with us. An astronomer can tell how many stars there are approximately in the galaxy. Also, he can tell how many of them have planets. Of course, somewhere there may be a civilization, but this is still not enough. It is necessary to single out the planets where the conditions for life are similar to those on Earth. Then, we need to decide what is the likelihood that life there will reach an intellectual level, and whether the intelligent civilization will get to the technical state with the possibility of contact. For example, the Aztecs were quite civilized, but they did not have radio equipment. And, well, the most important thing is whether civilization wants to make contact. An And finally, we should consider the ratio of the two existence duration of a technically advanced civilization to the age of the galaxy. Wait, what? Well, take our civilization as an example. At the beginning of the 20th century, we invented the radio. By the middle of the 20th century, radio technology had become sufficiently developed to support interstellar communication. But in the same years, atomic and thermonuclear weapons appeared, which could actually destroy our civilization. And the question is, how long does the period last when civilization has already reached the level of interstellar communication, but has not yet destroyed itself? It can be a very small ratio. For example, in our case, we have not lived even 100 years in this period, and our galaxy has existed for more than 13 billion years. The Drake equation can give a very wide range of values, depending on the assumptions. That happens because the values used in portions of the Drake equation are not well established. Some people received final estimates of the probability near 10 to the negative fifth power. That is a value close to zero. This can only mean that there is no one in our galaxy except us. Others received large values, up to 10 to the 6th power, which gives hope that there are millions of civilizations in the galaxy who are ready for contact and are looking for it. Today, it is already possible to make this interval of estimates much more accurate, since we know how many stars are in the galaxy. Also, we learned that almost every star has a planet, and most likely the next factor, which is the fraction of planetary systems with life, will be determined quite accurately in the coming decades. It is estimated that 1 in 100 planets are similar to Earth. Anyway, the last three factors are still undefined, and until we find at least one civilization, we will not know them for sure. Since 1995, scientists started to search for other civilizations and try to connect with them with even bigger enthusiasm. That was due to the discovery of planetary systems in other stars. At that time, no one thought that this would take place in the nearest future. There are many stars, more than 100 billion in our galaxy alone. Astronomers never doubted that stars have planets, but they also did not have the technical ability to detect them. For example, this is a photo of a bright star. Its light completely blocks the area around it in a telescope and doesn't allow to distinguish anything next to it. Of course, if the brightness of the star could be somehow extinguished, the planets would be visible. If you looked at our planets from the nearest stars, for example, Alpha Centauri, and extinguished our sun, then you would easily see Jupiter, Saturn, Venus, and Earth. But we will never see them from afar because the star blinds us. How can we solve this? Well, there's a way even for that. We do not see the planets, but let's take a look at the star. It cannot remain stationary if a planet revolves around it. And this will be a sign that there is a planet there. But how can we notice the movement of a star? We see a stream of light from every star, split by a prism or a diffraction grating. This is a spectrum. If the star is stationary, then the spectral lines stand still. If the star regularly moves, then these spectral lines will move, as due to the Doppler effect. But noticing the movement actually is not that easy. Why? Well, it's easy to explain on Jupiter, since it is the most massive planet in our system, and therefore affects the Sun more than the other planets. Jupiter orbits at about 20 kilometers per second. The Sun is thousands of times more massive than Jupiter, which means that it has 1,000 times less speed. It's 20 meters per second. On a cosmic scale, this is a very low speed. Anyway, scientists managed to see the movement. And at the end of 1995, the long-awaited event took place. For the first time, an exoplanet was discovered near Star 51 in the Pegasus constellation. By the way, exoplanet is the name for the planets of the other stars. Now we find over 100 of them per year, but it turned out that it is possible to find these planets differently. So if their orbit lies in a plane passing from our point of view in front of the star, then sometimes the planet will cover its star, and its light will darken a little bit for our telescopes. It is especially convenient to detect such eclipses with space telescopes. This method also allows the detection of planets passing in front of the star. Moreover, it allows you to explore them. When a planet passes in front of a star, the star's light is scattered into the planet's atmosphere. And so the light comes already with signs of the atmosphere, with some spectral lines that have arisen in the gaseous envelope of the planet. Therefore, we can study the chemical composition of the exoplanet's atmosphere. But what do we hope to find there? Well, there are specific biomarkers that, at least indirectly, can indicate the possible existence of life. Of course, those are the markers of life such as on Earth, as we don't yet know another one. One of these markers is the presence of oxygen in the atmosphere, best of all in the form of ozone. It highlights itself very clearly in the spectrum of ozone lines. Also, the presence of water is a sign of favorable conditions on the planet, and also the presence of methane that we actually found on Mars. And one more thing. Photosynthesis is ultimately responsible for the high oxygen levels and the thick ozone layer. Microbes emit methane and nitrous oxide into the atmosphere, and seaweeds emit chloromethane gas. These chemicals, when present in sufficient quantities, are indicators of life and are known as atmospheric biomarkers. Therefore, oxygen, methane, ozone, carbon dioxide, and water are the very spectral clues that can tell us if there is a terrestrial biosphere on the planet. If someday we find all five biomarkers in the spectrum of an Earth-like planet orbiting a Sun-like star, then this will be fantastically reliable proof that there is also Earth-like life there. Now, this is an actively researched area by theorists. They are trying to figure out how to explain the presence of all five biomarkers without life at once. But this is quite a difficult task. But what biomarkers have already been found on exoplanets? What else indicates super-developed civilizations? We will tell you all about that in the next video of the Search for Extraterrestrial Civilization series. Subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to hit the like button.